Functional programming has been part of .NET for the last 15 years. Ignored by many, the impact of functional programming was steadily increasing with every next release of the language. So much that some .NET programmers now say, "This is not the C# I know." Modern C#, that's what I will show you today. I will add a functional model to an existing object-oriented ASP.NET Core application along with some functional mappings. That will make the domain model much simpler, much shorter, and way more expressive. Stay with me, here it begins. This is the demo application modeling a bookstore. This page is showing the books with their authors, and this application has some nice features. Every element here is a separate link. The title is also a link to that book's details. And the C also list here, every element in this row is also a separate link. These are the nice features we have developed in the previous video, and there is nothing wrong with them, except the implementation. Look here. This is the strategy that formats authors of a book. But a strategy is returning a sequence of some objects, and that doesn't fit well in the view model. We must materialize that sequence into a list and also turn it back into innumerable because the tuple is not covariant. And look at the view model. Let me read it. It is an innumerable of pairs of innumerables. Wow, that's crazy. The root cause of all that mess in code is this interface. It just returns the innumerable. It's not expressive enough. This used to be a string before, and that was even worse because string doesn't have a structure. I was coping with that in the previous video, and you can watch it. It is the video dedicated to discriminated unions, another important aspect of functional programming. This is that discriminated union. I had to use records to simulate a discriminated union in .NET because C# still doesn't support discriminated unions. But anyway, the model is descriptive enough. Every part of a citation that you may see anywhere on the website is either an author of the book, plain text, or the title of the book. That is what these four records are telling us. And so, the book object, the domain model, is transformed into a sequence of citation segments. There are two supporting interfaces. To render a book, you need to render the list of authors. This interface is modeling that. And also to render a list of authors, you need to be able to render individual authors. This helper interface is coping with that. And each of these three interfaces is just returning a sequence of citation segments, an innumerable. And all those innumerables you saw in the view model, they come from this place. That is lacking a more expressive model for that concept. All that is leading to this. What shall we do with this? I have a friend who is also a programmer. All my friends are programmers. And in situations like this, he would say, "All right, what can we as superheroes do? We add a new type." That's what superheroes do in programming. Right besides the citation segments, we also define the entire citation that will contain them. A new model. Citation will be a sequence of segments. Consumers expect to iterate through them, but producers expect simplicity. This is the producer. It will return a citation, and that will make it simple. And the other two interfaces as well, author's list for matter, and the last, the author name for matter, they will all just return citations. No innumerable anymore. We don't need to implement the citation class yet. I'm still experimenting, you see. And if it turns out that the new class doesn't simplify the consumers, then that would indicate that I was wrong introducing it and I would delete it. Here, do you see the declaration of the view model now? Can you understand it when written this way? Of course, it is a sequence of author title citation pairs. And every element, every pair in this sequence will be one row in the table when rendered in HTML. This is very expressive and very easy to understand. And what about populating the view model? All this superfluous code goes away, and only the substance remains. I will now show you what it means for a class to be functional, developed in a functional style, why you would want to have such a class, and what impact it makes in places where you consume it. Why that makes your code better. So the hard part of this video is now about to begin. Before that, let me ask you a favor. If you liked this video so far and want others to discover it as well, the easiest way to help me with that is to press the like button. Thank you. And also, if you want to see the source code of this video, the source code is available to sponsors of this channel. There's the link to my Patreon page down in the description. Follow that link and become the sponsor of this channel. Help me retain this channel free for everyone else. Thank you very much for all the support you're giving. That will give you access to source code before and after this change I'm about to make, so you can download the source code and compare the two variants and see which one you find better. So, let's step to implementing this class. What does it mean for a class to be functional? For one thing, it must be immutable. Functional design is based on immutable types. The consumers of this citation class will need some ways to add a citation segment to an object. In a functional design, this method would return a new instance of the citation class and leave this instance intact. But I want more. I want to make the caller's life really easy. For example, by adding the addRange method for convenience. And remember that the citation class also implements the immutable of citation segments. This method can also accept an entire citation object. The public interface is now complete. Let's implement the details now. We need to keep the segments in some collection. But a mutable collection like a list is not appropriate in an immutable class. That is where we use immutable collections instead of the mutable ones. That is a very important part of functional development. Let me use the immutable list from the system collections.immutable namespace. And there is also an important protocol about defining constructors on these classes that contain immutable collections. Anyone wanting to instantiate this class would have to depend on the immutable list class. But why? That is the implementation detail. That should be hidden away from the consumers. Instead of exposing public constructors on classes like this one, we normally hide them, turn them private, and expose some static factory like an empty singleton. Notice that the empty singleton is using the immutable list.emptySingleton as well. My design is clicking with the existing .NET designs. That's very nice. As I said, the immutable method must always return a new instance. It must not change this one. Look, the immutable lists add method is also written with all these rules in mind. It doesn't change the list. No, it returns a new list with one element added. The same idea is with add range. The immutable list also has the add range convenient method for this. Lastly, let's implement the innumerable interface. I can also expose an implicit operator that turns a citation segment into a full-blown citation. Just assign a segment where a citation is required. Don't write this citation.empty.add. Just send the segment if you already have it. Let's move our attention to the classes that are producing objects of the citation class. All classes here, these are the concrete formatters, all classes are in red, none of them compiles. This one is formatting book author's full name. Let's fix it. I'll just remove all that superfluous code again. This method now only consists of the substance. But let's get to a real problem. This is the author list formatter, which is formatting authors in the academic style, like if there are multiple authors, you would see the first author and others, instead of listing every single author. Well, that is a real problem, and this implementation is fully procedural. Can you tell what this code is doing? Why would it be so hard to understand how this code is working? Well, it's because the implementation is not following the requirements exactly. There is a mapping, cognitive mapping, between the requirements and this algorithm here. I will delete this entire procedural implementation. You don't have to bother reading it. And I will write it all over again in a functional style. If you have a functional model like that citation class, then you can implement the entire mapping method as a mapping expression. Let's take up to three authors, you will see why three. Do the pattern matching like a sir. If the list is empty, that is the empty citation. If it is a single author, a list consisting of a single person object, then that author is the citation. I have added a helper method to format an author in academic style of formatting. The next pattern, if there are exactly two authors, then show both separated by a comma. Another useful helper, the comma property getter. And the last case is the first author followed by multiple authors. Format the first one, append a comma, and et al, and we are done. Look at this code. Do you know what it's doing? Of course you do. If you had requirements to format the authors list this way, then this function would read almost identically to what the requirements are saying. That is the huge advantage of functional modeling compared to traditional object-oriented modeling with procedural style methods. I have completed all other concrete formatters so that there is no red color anymore on the left. I'm assuring you that all those classes have become simpler than they were while they were object-oriented. And I can also assure you that the application is working the same as before, so I didn't break any functionality. But the internal structure of the application has become much better this time. Let this class implementation prove my point. And let me remind you again that if you want to download the source code, you can do that at Patreon. There is the link in the description where you can become a sponsor and get access to source code before and after this change so that you can compare object-oriented and functional implementation and see for yourself which one you find better. Continue learning about functional design and functional programming with C#. That is the future of C#, I'm assuring you. Watch this video about discriminated unions as a modeling tool, and also this one about functional records in C#, and enjoy using the latest C# features. They are just making wonderful code.